So I had to do something about it. That's why I came here. You know it's bad when you begin to look forward to spam. I started to read it obsessively. Then I got even more depressed because I wrote 3 emails to this Nigerian diplomat who needed help with a frozen bank account. Larry Ghana did not write me back once. The other day, I just couldn't wait to go to a focus group. I thought that I would make a friend there, but all the women were married, and I couldn't participate in the laundry detergent discussion because I take my laundry to the Chinese guys down the block. They cheat me. And I couldn't offer an opinion on the new bleach product they were testing because I just don't believe in bleach. Chemicals. People say that they're bad for you, but for me, I don't like my whites being unnaturally white. Who would? I guess you could say that the only visit that I wouldn't look forward to at this point would be 2 men in dark suits knocking on my door from the IRS wanting to discuss my tax returns with me. They're in order. They are. And I may be depressed, but I am just not that depressed. You know, I really hope that in my next life I can come back something like you. So beautiful and so dumb that I too could bask in that glow of ignorance you people have and everyone would want to do things for me. I meant that as a compliment.
I always take it that way when people say I have a dumb, ignorant glow.
But really, it's a compliment if you think about it.
Yes, thank you. I'm sure it is.
Sir? Sir? Yes, you, sir. I can't reveal your name to the entire waiting room. Will you please approach the desk? This is how it works at New York Psychiatry Associates. Based on a preliminary evaluation of your problem, we have compiled a list of doctors for your consideration. Now, every day at 1 o'clock, you'll meet a different doctor in one of our evaluation offices, which are these little rooms down that long hall. Now, you and your prospective doctor will have a brief chit-chat. And if the two of you decide that it's a good fit, then you'll choose that doctor and you can begin your therapy.
So I get to see which doctors work best for me and my problems.
Think of it as an opportunity. They'll be pulling out all their best stuff to get you to begin therapy with them. Your first appointment is with Dr. Jameson. Now.
I'm going to ask you a couple of questions about yourself and get to know you a bit. And then you'll decide whether or not you'd like to continue.
Understandable.
What do you mean, understandable?
I just understand that we may not be a very good fit.
Oh, do you always jump in and assume the worst?
I'm sorry, did I say something wrong?
Oh, a single word can convey just a depth of meaning.
Understandable?
It was your tone.
My tone?
Mr. Lorber, I've been practicing psychiatry in private practice for the past 11 years. I received my psychiatric training from a little college called Harvard University. You ever heard of that one? Not too many people have. As a graduate of the Massachusetts General and McLean Hospital Psychiatric Residency Training Program. So if you're going to continue to be insulting, perhaps you should see another doctor. What is bugging you, Mr. Lorber?
Well, the only things I look forward to in life these days are what other people would genuinely avoid. Like last week, I was visited by a Jesuit Bible salesman, and now I'm hoping that he'll come back.
isolate it in a sentence.
Isolate?
Your Jesuit Bible salesman, what's he like?
Well, he limps.
Okay. Okay, you look forward to seeing your limping Jesuit Bible salesman. Say it in a sentence.
You mean like...
Exactly, exactly. Let me hear you say it.
I look forward to visits from my Jesuit Bible salesman.
How the fuck can you look forward to something with a monotone like that? I mean, do you really look forward to seeing a Jesuit limp up your staircase, carrying a stack of Bibles, you know, come into your door to renounce Satan and all his works? I mean, if you really, really look forward to seeing a Jesuit knocking on your goddamn door, then let me hear you say it! Let me hear you say it with some goddamn expression in your voice!
I look forward to visits from my Jesuit Bible salesman.
What does he do?
He limps!
Then say it with a limp! Get up and limp around the room! Engage in it! Come on! There you go! Now say it!
I look forward to visits from my Jesuit Bible salesman.
What does he do?
He limps.
All right. Bring it all together now.
I look forward to visits from my limping Jesuit Bible salesman.
Again.
I look forward to visits from my limping Jesuit Bible salesman.
What?
Who limps.
Bring it all together.
I look forward to visits from my limping Jesuit Bible salesman.
Again.
I look forward to visits from my limping Jesuit Bible salesman.
Again.
I look forward to visits from my limping Jesuit Bible salesman!
That's good. That's real good. Sit down. How's that feel? Does it feel engaged?
Yeah, engaged. Yeah, I would say that, yes. Engaged.
You know, caring about things begins by being totally engaged in them. I am very, 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 very strict. And I have a behavioral approach that will help you with your detachment. We'll start with your tone, and then eventually work on that little walk of yours. Not just the metaphorical walk of life, but literally, how you walk. Try incorporating some of what we've done today into your daily life.
I mean?
Lose a fucking monotone, pal. I'll kick your nuts in, okay?
I'll try.
To start. Okay.
You know, today I was really hoping that we could talk about work.
Ah, the inevitable conundrum. How must we enjoy what inherently sounds so bad?
Work.
Not like they call it play. Well, you're in luck, because if work-related anxiety is the reason why you're here, then I'm your doctor. Mr. Lorber, my name is Dr. Eikenberry. Why don't you tell me about it?
I feel paranoid at work. Doctor, my boss.
What's your name?
Arlene.
Darlene?
No, Arlene.
Ah, Arlene. Continue.
She makes me feel paranoid. I am convinced that she listens in on my phone calls. She reads my emails. I think she's got my cubicle bugged. And I wouldn't be surprised if she had my home bugged, too. I mean, I lie at home at night imagining the of her high heels, and I fall asleep. And I dream about her walking over to my desk. I look down at her black leather stilettos, up her firm legs and torso and hand, and down her long, slender arm, and she's holding one of my emails with those perfectly manicured red fingernails. And she wants to go over grammar with me. And I suck at grammar. I wouldn't know the difference between a parenthetical element and a parenthesis, I'm telling you.
A parenthetical element is any sentence element which interrupts the forward movement of a clause. A parenthesis is a punctuation mark used to insert information into a text. I was a writing major before I switched to psychotherapy. Continue.
I can't take it, Dr. Eikenberry. I can't stop feeling paranoid at work and worrying about my grammar. I don't know what she wants from me.
Fuck her.
What?
I said what you need to do is fuck your boss.
I'm sorry, I don't think I heard you correctly. Did you just say I should fuck my boss?
Fuck her or quit.
Fucking my boss is the last possible thing that I would ever want to do.
Oh, you want to fuck her. It's pretty obvious.
No, I do not.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't.
You do want to fuck her.
No, I do not.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't.
You like men?
No.
You sure?
Yes.
You're positive you're not a homosexual?
Yes.
When you masturbate, who do you think about, men or women?
I think about women, Doctor.
Let's play a little word association. After I say a word, you tell me the first thing that comes to mind.
Fine.
Do it with a little energy.
Okay.
Cat.
Dog.
Black.
White.
Cowboy.
Indian.
Arlene. Arlene. Arlene.
Erection.
Thank you, Siggy. The dream's not about the grammar, it's about the high heels, don't you think?
You're right. Grammar, I mean, it's so obvious. I want to fuck my boss. Either that or I need to get another job. I want to fuck Arlene, Jesus.
Speaking of grammar, something tells me that your Longfellow could use a little exercise.
How could you tell?
Your id is an obvious conflict with your ego. Us Freudians, we may be old-fashioned, but it works. I hope you'll choose me.
I'm sorry I'm late. Dr. Galfano? I was on a subway and I got stuck in a tunnel.
How does that make you feel, Mr. Lauber?
I don't like being late.
I'm not talking about tardiness, you weasel. I'm talking about being stuck.
Well, if you must know, it reminded me of my father. Now, what is it with you people?
Share the metaphor with me, Mr. Lauber.
I haven't talked to my dad in 10 years. I mean, I've been pissed at him ever since I was 16. But the final straw is when he refused to give me the family business. He said, too many headaches making picture frames in this goddamn country. Goddamn unions, he said. I told him I had a plan that would make the business work. He told me he was doing me a favor. And he shut the whole operation down. 1,500 workers, 2 million picture frames a year down the tubes. Sort of like being stuck in the subway. Down the goddamn tubes.
Reminds me of my dad and the falling out we had with Darian. I really, really loved her. He said, no Galifano will ever marry a colored girl. He called her a colored girl. Over my dead Italian ass, he said. I don't know why, but I broke it off. I haven't spoken to my dad in years.
My God. I am so sorry.
It was terrible. It was terrible. I wish I could speak to my dad.
I miss my dad, too.
My dad died a year ago when I tried to call him. The operator cut in and she said, haven't you heard? And I said, well, no, I haven't, bitch.
The operator said that? I tried to pick up the phone last night, but I couldn't even dial the number.
Because your finger is in your ass. Get it out.
I'm gonna call my dad. I am.
Even though it's been 10 years?
I don't want to miss one single solitary day more.
That's good. That's good. You need to learn to let go, you squirmy little fag.
Why do you have to call me names like that?
Because it'll keep you real, Roman. It'll keep you real.
You're right. I don't want to miss another day.
What do you do for a living?
I'm the executive assistant to an operations manager at an investment bank.
Do you like it?
I'm not very happy with work, beginning with the cubicle that I work in, all the way to the recent confrontation that I had with my boss.
I'm not very happy with my work either. I work out of this place. My practice is in this clinic because I can't afford my own practice. Let me look at this room. It has no character. It's dull. It's like an asylum.
Well, at least I get to decorate my cubicle the way that I want to.
I do hope to see you soon, douchebag.
Dr. Shin, pleased to meet you.
Roman, pleased to meet you. Did you say Shin?
I took my wife's name.
You did?
Yes. So how are you feeling?
Not bad. Not bad.
Everything okay emotionally? Physically?
Well, physically could be better, I guess.
Really? Physicality is my specialty. Tell me about it.
A while back when I was watching the news, I started doing some push-ups. But after about 3 push-ups, I just lost it. I felt listless, weak, achy. So now, every time I try and work out, I give up before I even get started. Even when I'm feeling physically good, it's like I'm dead.
You're not dead. You just got to accept that the world is all shit.
That's ridiculous, Doctor.
If you let me finish, I said, you just got to accept that the world is all shit sometimes. But most times, the world is great.
I'm sorry, but it's just not that easy.
Do you remember what you were watching on the news when you couldn't do the push-ups?
On the news? No. No, I don't listen to the programs. I just kind of let them play in the background.
Oh, you were listening, buddy.
I don't know. I mean, it was something about Iran or Iraq or Ethiopia or something like that.
Which one? Iran, Iraq, or Ethiopia?
I don't know. I think it was Ethiopia.
Ethiopia got to you.
Yeah, I guess so. I guess it did.
Well, tell me about it.
It was this story about this guy who was the biggest torturer in Ethiopia during their red period or something like that, and how it was 10 years later and he was working as a hotel bellhop in North Carolina when he got into the elevator with a woman that he tortured back in Ethiopia who was working as a chambermaid at the same hotel, and how she subsequently brought him to justice here in the USA.
Go on.
They showed the woman being interviewed on TV, and she lifted up her shirt, and she had these crisscross scars from whip wounds that were all over, just everywhere, all over her back.
And you were doing push-ups at the time? Was your shirt off?
Yeah, so?
So how did you feel doing push-ups with your healthy back while here was this woman on TV with a back full of scars?
I don't know. I guess that's why I stopped doing push-ups.
Is that the reason?
I don't know. You know what? You tell me how I felt.
You were doing push-ups. You were healthy and strong. And here's this woman on television with bloody scars all over her back. You tell me how you really felt.
I guess I felt lucky.
Specifically, how did you feel lucky?
I felt lucky to be alive. Is that wrong?
Never in a million years. It's healthy to feel lucky. Or even guilty when you see other people suffering. As long as you care about them. Do you care?
Immensely.
And how do you feel now? So, good. I really hope you'll choose me.
How many doctors have you seen so far?
Well, you'll be my fifth.
Fifth? My God, I don't have a chance. You must be all shrinked out by now.
Actually, all the doctors have been pretty good so far.
Who have you seen?
I saw Dr. Jameson, Dr. Galfano, Dr. Eikenberry, and Dr. Shin.
Dr. Shin, Eikenberry, Galfano, and Jameson.
Mm-hmm.
Those guys are geniuses. You probably had a breakthrough with each one of them. You're never going to pick me. I might as well leave right now.
I guess that you're right. I don't see how you could possibly top them. In fact, I think I'm pretty much cured.
Cured?
Yeah. I don't even think I need therapy anymore.
Really?
Yeah. Just this interview process has been therapeutic enough. I mean, you guys should offer the process as the cure. It has been an amazing week. Thank you.
Before you go, Mr. Roman, could you tell me what kind of breakthroughs you had with each one of these doctors?
It's okay by me.
Go on.
Well, Dr. Jameson helped coach me through a general condition of numbness. Dr. Galfano helped me to heal the estrangement that I had with my dad. Dr. Eikenberry made me think about my work, and particularly my boss, in a completely new light. And Dr. Shin made me realize that caring about the world around me was a pretty normal thing, even if it meant that I felt lucky when bad things weren't happening to me.
But he didn't cover death with you.
Death? No.
Well, Mr. Loba, one day you are gonna die. How do you feel about that?
I try not to think about it too often.
Well, one day, Mr. Loba, whether you smoke or whether you don't smoke, whether you drive cars really fast or obey the traffic laws, whether you scale a cliff or parachute off a building or ice skate on a creaky lake or a man-made rink, whether you follow the leader like an Indian or rule like a chief, whether you eat healthy or indulge in fatty foods, whether you obey the law or say fuck you to the man, whether you screw like a champion without a rubber, or get your blood checked for sexually transmitted diseases every 3 months, just as certainly as we breathe the air around us, just as sure as the sun sets and the world spins, one day your heart will stop beating. The oxygen won't flow through your lungs into your brain, and you will absolutely, positively, die. How does that make you feel?
Not particularly good.
I would think horrified is a better word, don't you?
Horrified, yeah, that's pretty much how I feel. Thank you. Thank you very much.
You don't have to feel that way.
I don't?
No.
Why not?
Choose me, Mr. Lorber, and I'll tell you.
Okay.
We will meet 3 times a week. Every week. For several... Even years. It'll be rough at first. But eventually you'll come to understand that there is a natural order to things. And you'll smile. You will.
I'm sitting on top of the world. I'm rolling along. Yes, rolling along. And I'm quitting the blues of the world. I'm singing a song. Yes, singing a song. Glory, hallelujah, I just told the parson. Hey, Pa, get ready to call. Just like Humpty Dumpty, I'm going to fall. And I'm sitting on top of the world. I'm rolling along, rolling along. Don't want any million, I'm getting my share. I've only got one suit, just one, that's all I can wear. A bundle of money don't make me feel gay. A sweet little honey is making me sad. And I'm sitting, sitting on top, top of the world. I'm rolling along, rolling along. And I'm quitting, quitting the blues, blues of the world. I'm singing a song, yes, singing a song.